I'm Per Bak from Social Entrepreneurs in Denmark. We're here in Copenhagen on Social Enterprise Day, 15th of November 2018, live streaming from different social enterprises in Copenhagen.
We have the largest urban honey production in the whole of Europe in this project. So last year we made 5.5 tons of honey on the rooftops around Copenhagen, working with community groups, social organizations, and different sorts of businesses. Yeah. We have projects with social organizations, with private businesses, with social housing associations, with municipality parks, with water authorities. You can see them around here. What's fascinating about it is that every street, every park, every garden, every window box, every season, every week produces a honey of its own unique colour, its own flavour. This is a map of Copenhagen in
honey colours.
In honey from 2018 to 2017 to 2016 over here.
So there's a huge difference in...
It's a huge difference.
Colour and...
And that energy and diversity is something that we celebrate,
yeah,
and needs to be celebrated.
Looks like 2018 was a really colourful year.
It was a colourful year. It's been a long, dry summer.
Yeah. Was it a good season?
It was a good season. This is Louisa.
Hello, Louisa.
We're making these packs here where you can have different parts of the city, so from the botanical gardens, Österkolb, Frederiksberg and Amager. This is Arif, who's our beekeeper.
Hi.
Hi.
You know, if there's one thing that we're doing in this organisation, it is to try and make sure that the passive consumers, who've been the kind of, you know, the root of the economic system we have now, that you just consume things and then throw them away afterwards, are changed to being active co-producers. And that's something that bees can teach us.
Yeah.
So every spoonful of honey that we sell or create, we try and encourage people to plant a flower for the next harvest. And that creates an environment that is both richer for bees, wild bees, butterflies, other kinds of insects. It makes the city more beautiful. It brings opportunities to create spin-off businesses in fruit or berry production. It encourages people to see their properties in different ways where they can plant things that aren't there before. And in that way, we can build a business up around it.
Well, actually, we didn't start in Denmark. We started in Africa, where Thor,
the founder.
Yeah, he founded Social Foodies. He started in Africa by founding first a dairy and then a chocolate factory in Cape Town. And he founded the chocolate factory in 2009. So, yeah, it's a bit before that, and he lived in Africa for a couple of years to make sure that everything was going well, yeah, to start lots of projects. And then he went back to Denmark to start Social Foodies on that ground. So we kind of had something to start on. We had the chocolate factory where we still get all of our chocolate from. Yeah, so we also offer coffee, and now we have the map on the screen here. So as you maybe can see, our coffee comes from Uganda, which is also a Danish coffee farm. It's called Den Bæredygtige Bønne. I'm not sure how
sustainable coffee bean.
The sustainable coffee bean in English. Yeah. So yeah, on this map you can kind of see like almost all of our projects, but we keep starting new ones. And what's kind of most important is for us to educate the Africans. We, for example, our factory in Cape Town, we hire the poor people that lives in the townships around Cape Town. Yeah, and then offering them education and a good salary for the work that they do. And we have also actually a very good example for right now. It's very Now is the time for Christmas calendars, and of course we make one as well. So each day there is 2 pieces of chocolate, and these pieces of chocolate are of course made on Cocoa Fair, our chocolate factory, but also they're hand packed. So they have to pack each one of these chocolates and put a little sticker on there. And the packing has given 26 people in Africa a job for 26 days.
Just to pack them.
We have them right here.
Yeah.
A little picture of them. And in average, they got around double the minimum wages. Yeah, it's a bit difficult. Just to pack the chocolate, and then they send it to Denmark, and this one is put together by Frak on Nørrebro, which is a
it's also a Danish enterprise.
Yeah,
creating
it is social
jobs for young people.
Yeah, creating jobs for young people in Nørrebro.
So you have actually created jobs, small jobs here in Denmark, and jobs in Africa.
Also in Africa.
Making the calendar. Do you know roughly how many did you make?
So in Africa it was 26 people, and in I can see, because we have a picture of the ones in Denmark, so that would be around 10 young people from Nørrebro. So around 36 people just for making this. On top of 2 pieces of chocolate a day, you get 5 gift cards. So that you need to come and visit us in the shop, because it's very hard to put ice cream in the Christmas calendar. But then we will just give you a gift card to come and taste our delicious ice cream as well. So also the flødeboller is on here, of course. You'll get a gift card to a flødeboller, so you can taste that as well.
It's a Craftsman company. Of course, it's social economic, because that was the way it was founded back in 1929. And it has been continuously working on, you know, making good products out of, you know, in craftsmanship. So we are very proud that our blind and partial sighted employees are very skilled in these areas. And then we also, for selling our products, we have shops around in Denmark, different places, because it's also very important to get out to our customers and be able to communicate with them in a local area. So we have these 5 shops, and we are opening one in a very short time, a new one in Ikastbrande. So the whole idea is that we want to create more jobs for blind and partial sighted people. So that's the whole idea, our mission, you can say. But our DNA is that we are craftsmen, skilled, make beautiful products, sustainable products, and we are looking very much into, as much as we can, materials from Denmark and design from Denmark.
Yeah, so here is Kasper is making a chair, as one of the chairs I showed you in there. So,
I won't step on the line.
No, it's yeah.
It's a common thing around here.
Yeah. You are used to.
Yeah, it's mostly me.
Yeah. So it has to be pretty tight.
Yeah. As tight as possible.
As tight as possible. Yeah. Is it difficult?
No, this is pretty easy. But the chairs are.
That's another thing.
Yeah, it's a much more difficult task. Yes.
This is more like one direction. Yeah. And the chairs are more.
Yeah. This is the hardest part. First, I just put all the way, you know, I put it on this here.
Yeah,
like that, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Fill that all up, and then so all this here is without any nuts. It's just, and then when I go the other way, I just take a smaller piece, and then I can hide the nut in here in the middle. Way in here.
Oh, yeah. So there's the nut is in between. So
yeah. So there's no visible nut somewhere on the fence.
It's beautiful craftsmanship.
Thank
and
you.
It's very, very tight.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
It's actually it's a pretty decent seat as well.
Yes. Yeah. Soft to sit on.
Yeah, but not too soft.
But not too soft.
Yeah. It's actually pretty good.
How much can I ask you? What can you see and what can you not see?
Well, compared to a normal sitting person, I have about 10%.
10% vision.
Yes, yeah. But I'm mostly on the detail, so I can see pretty far away, but
yeah.
It's just not very clear what I'm looking at. I can't see your color eye from here, but I can see your face and I can
yeah.
see when you smile. But if you go over there, then it's
difficult.
Yeah, then I can basically just see who you are and that's it. No, I can see the eyebrows, I can see your
details.
No,
and so.
Exactly.
And how about the work? How is it to?
Well, this kind of work doesn't really require much. I don't even have to look at it. I could do it with my eyes closed. So
yeah.
It's not, I don't really need my
no.
eyes. But I still, every time I have to do this, I get close enough anyway. So everything I have within 15 to 20 centimeters, I can see some pretty
yeah.
pretty clearly. So,
yeah.
So it is.
It
combines pretty good with this job, actually. It's,
yeah, it's a good work too.
Yeah, just within my limits of,
mm.
of what I can see. And,
yeah.
and when I make the chairs, sometimes I put this on, you know, just go around, check, is everything looking good, and I can use this to, you know,
to
put some of them are not quite in place, I can push them in.
Mm.
Adjust with the.
Adjust with that,
yeah.
Yes.
When we opened all these shops 30 years ago, it was more like simply a community project, so to speak. It was not meant to be run or to be commercial at all. So there was not a triple bottom line, there was only a social bottom line. So the community changed, the neighborhood changed, times changed. So we need to work on, you know, being run commercial as well. I don't think we're becoming slowly becoming good at it. So Sonja, we also had to change slowly from being this more like a drop-in center in the old days. We had to change and accommodate to the new people living in the neighborhood. What do they want? They wanted something different than those who used to live here. So we slowly changed Sonja to become like a modern Vesterbro hip cafe. But we still, and I think we succeeded, we still wanted to keep the DNA of, it's a community, it's a place where you feel at home and everybody's welcome. No matter how much or little money you have or the resources you may have or not, everybody's welcome there. You can be a volunteer, you can be an intern, or you can be a customer buying a coffee there.
Yeah. Sonja is actually, cafe has the name actually from a
very old but famous children's
television.
Show
yeah
television show that just turned 50 years, so we actually
70,
yeah we're actually celebrating this Monday. It was 50 years ago it was broadcasted the first time. So that children's show is about a girl called Sonja. She lives in Saxogade, this is the name of the street, and it's about her childhood at Vesterbro, this neighborhood in the 60s. And it was so different, I mean, and it was such a different childhood she had at the time than the children today would have in this neighborhood. But actually we took the names on the shops from that children's show. So Sonja's sister and brother is called Heidi and Bjarne, like the store we just visited, and her mother is Norma's. Like
oh, yeah.
the store there, and her mother's boyfriend is Frede, like Frede's woodshop. So we stuck to the name and the story behind, because it's also a story about sticking together in a tough environment. So Sonja is definitely challenged with the childhood here at Vesterbro, but it's still also about the community sticking together and taking care of each other. And I think Vesterbro, even though it has changed, has this story of sticking together and taking care of each other, and we want to cling on to that,
strengthen community, yeah.
Exactly,
yeah,
yeah. So
great.
One of these co-creation partners is Løgsmarked.
Yeah.
So this is not our shop, but one of our very nice partners in the street, and what they do is that they sell they sell different, flower and seeds and vegetables, but they sell them in
there's no packaging.
No plastic. Exactly. So you only buy as much as you need, so there's no food waste or less food waste, and you bring your own packaging and reuse it.
Yeah, we try to avoid as much plastic as possible, packaging, and then the waste, of course, because people they can buy the quantities they want here. And organic food, this is very important for us, and biodynamic, then you can have a... We just received the biodynamic fruits and vegetables here today.
Great.
Like
so
every,
all is
Thursday.
Organic and,
yeah,
more
and
biodynamic.
As much local as possible.
Yeah.
So the more local, the more sustainable.
How many products do you have actually?
We have around 350 products around.
350?
Yeah,
yeah,
in total.
And that includes vegetables,
yes,
fruits
and
nuts,
everything.
Flour.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
Even wine.
Even
he
wine.
Sells,
yeah,
a very
liquid
good wine.
Yes.
How do you
French
sell
wine? Well, we sell it then. Beside, if you can have a look, if you want. I mean,
come along.
Yes.
I'll show
yeah.
you. So you buy a bottle.
Yeah.
And then you simply fill the bottle, and then you pay for the bottle the first time. But once you bring it back, you get your money returned. And then part of the internships we create is actually washing these bottles in the washing machines next door. So that's part of our partnership, that we create the internships, or the people we help, they're trained also cleaning these things.
Yeah.
I want to acknowledge and appreciate that you make this day of social enterprise. I think we have such a important message to the world that we can have a sustainable way of consuming, that we can do more with our consumption than just please ourselves. We can help others, and we can help the environment. So I really hope that this, what you do now, will help bring along the agenda of thinking about more than consumption or yourself.